today, there are lots of problems. But in the process, what happened? What changes did it make to me or to all of us? We used to say government, NGO, the traditional term. I wasn't reworked. Well, I was an NGO and then I'm not an NGO. In India, there's lots of politics in the NGO sector, what we are, what we are not. I see government as the basic organization that must deliver in a democracy. There are no excuses for non-delivery. So if the government is to deliver, as a responsible citizen, what's my role? My role is to make that government deliver through whatever I can do with it, against it, for it, however. In that definition of roles, I have been made to go back on some of my basic instincts, which was not to work with government. We've had to work with government, we've had to work with several people. Santosh Matthew is a friend who works in the government, and many of the lines of the law are given by very good, honest civil servants, whose creed, as a creed, are the most corrupt in India. But within them, they've been fantastic people. Santosh Matthew, but there's a friend of his called Harsh Mandal, who's quite famous in India, well known. And N.C. Saxena, who used to be director of the academy where they trained IAS officers, gave that one line to us, which is an important line. I won't go through the features of the law because I don't have time. In one, there is an override on what can be denied. We didn't know what to put in the positive list, what to put in the negative list. We were packing our minds. And the senior civil servant came and said, oh, it's extremely simple. What a member of the legislature can see, what a member of parliament can see, I can see. But I send that person to parliament. I send that person to the legislative assembly. So that override the state. So now in the act, we all have the powers, at least for information, that a member of parliament and a member of the legislature has. Similarly, there's a human rights override, there's a corruption override. If there's a human rights issue or a issue of corruption, the commission can overrule anything in the act and put it in the public domain. We also have, for life and liberty, 48 hours within which the information must be disclosed. We also have penalties. You know that. Penalties in India is a big issue. The Prime Minister, when we went to deal with him, said, you remove penalties because it's going to harm my officers. And we said to him, we don't want to put in penalties, you keep the law. Then we lobbied with the, before the 2003 election, general elections, we lobbied with what is called the United Progressive Alliance, which is what is government today in India, which is not right-wing, but centrist part. We lobbied with them, we lobbied with the left, we lobbied with everybody. They put it into their manifesto. When they won the election, which was unexpected, they didn't expect to win themselves, but they won the election and then they had the manifesto, so we asked for accountability. Then they set up, they published a document called the National Common Minimum Program. I think this is a kind of a dialectic. That's why I'm saying, please don't feel disheartened. And in the program, they promised us an Employment Guarantee Act, about which I haven't spoken at all, which is extremely important in India today, because it's taken right to information to every poor person all over the country by giving them a right to guaranteed employment for 100 days, which can be taken to court. It's been a huge, huge achievement, because it's in a sense huger, because the entire international climate is against giving any right to work to anybody. But we got it. Because of right to information and dissents, because we understood there is money in government which it can give to people, why isn't it giving employment? So they set up this one, then when this became so, Mrs. Gandhi was not made Prime Minister, or she didn't want to become Prime Minister. She still couldn't be sidelined, so they made her chair this committee on the National Common Minimum Program and said you can have your own council. They asked me and my friend Jean Drees, who is a very, very important activist economist, who's written all these books with Dr. Amartya Sen, which he won the Nobel Prize for Economics. Very well-known man, a Belgian, he's now a nationalized Indian, by the way. And he speaks fluent Hindi, and of course, except for his appearance, he's an Indian. So they asked Jean and me to become members of the committee, and we did. My campaigns were with me, but the activists were divided. Half saying she should go and half saying you shouldn't go. One half said you'll be co-opted by the government. You've been co-opted to get the credibility, you shouldn't go. The other half said we've been fighting for democratic space. We've got it and you must go. Anyway, I was pushed in. And because of that, we were able to monitor the act. And the act is being made by a group of people outside. But the first draft of the act was made by Justice P.B. Sawant, terrible act which was passed in Parliament was made by a committee set up by the government under H.T. Shorey. This act is not anybody's single contribution, as yours isn't either. It is a huge lot of people have contributed to the act, and eventually it is political will in the leading parties that pushed it through Parliament because the bureaucrats simply did not want the bill. So please don't concentrate only on Parliament. A word of advice would be, please see what the civil servants are doing. I know you've all seen Yes Minister. You've seen Yes Minister, you know the role of the civil servant very, very well. How many of you have seen this BBC serial called Yes Minister? It's revealing as to how the civil servants manipulate politicians. And I can tell you in my brief stint as a civil servant in India that it is true. So therefore, you'll have to deal with civil servants. They never come up front. They're part of the woodwork. But when they come out, there's devastation. So I really think you should really make sure that civil servants are also made to realize that they cannot do what they're doing. In India today, every single document, we were asking for labor lists which could not be made public, as you saw in this. We were asking to see records at the level of the village council. Today, letters written by the Prime Minister to Mrs. Gandhi and Mrs. Gandhi to the Prime Minister, one saying, you have to amend this act now. They're all resisting it. And the other one saying, you cannot. Mrs. Gandhi saying, you cannot amend the act, you must allow it full implementation. There's a rift inside the party, but it's in the public domain. So it gives us space to fight more, go and lobby more, so that the act is not amended. And they're amending because the Chief Justice of India says he will not be ruled, the Supreme Court will not come under the jurisdiction of the right to information. You know what? Utter nonsense. Because if the law is supreme, I mean, it's for everybody. So the Justice of the Supreme Court is as liable to have his assets in the public domain as anybody else. It's bringing up extraordinary contradictions. It's showing us the extraordinary contradictions in governance. It's giving birth to a new kind of politics. Very difficult in India. Eroded with corruption, as yours is. But it's giving birth to a new kind of politics. So actually, you didn't do well yesterday, but you're doing extremely well in the larger interest of the Philippines. And I'm absolutely sure you will win this battle. I'm sorry, it was a lack of time. I brought a wonderful part of our campaign, which I'm sure the Philippines also has in plenty, because I've heard outside the Philippines, young people sing and perform. You must use your culture. If you are, you're very good. If not, please add more. If you are, please add more. I wanted to show you one of Shankar's favorite songs, which is now sung all over the country, and we also had a spoof, you know, of the ruling party in a challenge of scams which we took all over the country. Anyway, now if you give me 1 minute, I'll just show you the song and then I'll end. But before that, I don't know if in these rooms you can shout slogans, but I'm an activist, I'm not really a lawyer, as you can see. There's one which we always end our meetings with in India, now in the Hindi-speaking area. You can't speak, there are 17 languages in India. So you can't use the same language everywhere, of course. But and then there's a language politics, which is very strong in India. If you use one language in the wrong language, you're politically wrong. Anyway, but we say, ladenge jitenge, that means we'll struggle and we'll win. Of course, we will struggle and we will win. We will win. There's no question. Because if any kind of ethics has to prevail in the world, whether it's climate change, whether it's screwing our lives up, or whether it's anything else, or whether it's the consumption of energy, if it's anything. If we don't have transparency and accountability, we are doomed. And it's not just Philippines and India, it's the world. And that's why Tony is so important, because it keeps the flag flying there. So if it's climate change, what are they doing to destroy the climate? Only transparency will show. So we are on a good wicket internationally. Transparency is crucially important. But Can I sort of shout the slogan? And you'll have to shout the slogan with me and then the song.
Yes.
Okay. We'll struggle!